Welcome to the podcast series on National Education Policy 2020 by the Center of Excellence in Teacher Education Initiative at Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. For this podcast, we plan to interview educationists and other stakeholders to share their responses and insights on different chapters of the education policy. Over to our host of today.
So we welcome Dr. Disha Nawani, Dean School of Education, and to this NEP 2020 podcast on the issue of dropouts and the access of education. So welcome, ma'am.
Thank you.
And so if you just can start it off. So today's podcast is about understanding dropouts in context to universal access to education as talked in NEP. So when you see that there is a enrollment rates happening as well due to Sarvesh Abhiyan and due to many other factors, but also there is a huge dropouts that is happening across from grade 1 to secondary grades. So how do you see this scenario?
Yeah, so enrollment and dropouts have nothing to do with each other, right? You enroll in the school, and whether you stay on or drop out depends on several other factors. So even though the enrollment has gone up, the dropout continues to be a challenge, especially as you see children moving up the ladder. The challenges kind of increase.
Yeah. So what can be the factors maybe responsible for these dropouts of children in schools?
So the policy recognizes the problem of dropout, and that's a good thing that it does have a separate section which says the children drop out and the dropout rate keeps increasing as the child goes up or as you move up the education ladder. And there could be several reasons for dropout, but that they have not really gone into. They are more focused in terms of solutions that are offered by the policy. So they say that the aim really to address the needs of dropout children are twofold. One is to prevent children from dropping out, and the other is to get the children back into the school, the children who dropped out. So that's kind of makes sense. So you're focusing on both bringing children back to school and also identifying factors which will probably lead them to dropping out and preventing them. But the focus is more on prevention and not really identification. So the strategies they've talked about is, one, you have a good kind of quality education for the children in schools, and which means good infrastructure, transport facilities, also support from the community in terms of bridge courses which help children bridge the gap and then get back into school. Then they've talked of tracking students, both in terms of the learning levels and where they are, and having counselors in school who are going to counsel students and keep a tab on them, basically, and wherever they are facing challenges, kind of address those challenges. The third is they're also talking about overhauling curriculum and making it more relevant to the child. But these are not really discussed in detail, but the factors which I mentioned, when they're talking about incentives to excellent teachers, now what excellent really means is not very clear. But I assume motivated, committed, trained teachers who can sort of deal with the problems that these children are having. And so having counselors in school and stuff and having good teachers. And they're also talking about multiple pathways like the non-formal education or the open distance learning or vocational education for children who are likely to drop out. They're talking of a private public philanthropic partnership, which is a new term which makes it a little more politically correct, I guess, from their end. So they want the civil society to be involved in their initiatives, and they want the civil society to also help them help address the needs of these children. And they're talking that the policy talks a lot about volunteerism, encouraging volunteerism among people, having old retired people or local experts to sort of partner with the government in terms of addressing the needs of dropout children. So that's the section basically. That's what the section looks like. So it talks, it acknowledges the problem of dropout. It tries to give strategies, suggest strategies which may help prevent dropout and also get back the children into school. Yeah, so that's what the section is all about. And the one, so it's all very good, but only the one major problem is that they need children drop out of school because of multiple reasons, right? I mean, there could be migration, children of seasonal migrant labor who have to travel from one place to another, and so they're constantly on the move when they drop out of school. There could be transport issues that your school is like not physically within accessible distance, or you need transport to go to school. The issues of safety, distance, then children may have special needs which are not really addressed in school. There's poverty, of course, which is like overrated and which is a genuine factor. There's child labor, the needs of the family, especially they keep increasing as you go up, as children grow older, so they get pulled out. There could be corporal punishment. There could be discrimination in school because of where you come from, who you are. There could be infrastructural issues like lack of toilets, especially in case of girls. Lack of toilets becomes very important and they kind of, you know. So there is also the failure, the fact that you fail in exams, the fact that you're humiliated, laughed at, discriminated against. So there are several factors which one needs to recognize before proposing strategies. Because strategies are not, it's not a homogeneous group. Which is kind of dropping out. You can't say that boys, Dalit students are dropping out, or girls are dropping out, or tribal children are dropping out. And then there are this intersectionality that they kind of intersect with each other in interesting ways. So I think one important thing is one needs to understand why children are dropping out. And like I said before, the reasons vary from a person to person, child to child, family to family, region to region. And there are several factors, like caste, class, religion, ethnicity, gender, this, that, and the other. So one needs to have a sense of what really is happening in school or at home because the children are dropping out. And then you propose strategies which are more comprehensive, which are more related, which make more sense, and then kind of then address the problem.
So thank you, ma'am, for providing an overview of what the policy says and I think some of the cons or some of the things that has not been there in the policy. So as you rightly mentioned that the policy speaks about or gives recommendations on the idea of gender, caste, class or the disability. So can you, and also you brought the idea of intersectionalities between each of this context of gender, caste, class or disabilities, right? So can you briefly comment on these intersectionalities and to what has been recommended for dropouts in each of these marginalities?
See, in education particularly, we have a tendency to homogenize groups or schools or strategies or like solutions, problems, this, that, and the other. There is a common, we club differences together. We don't really recognize the differences in groups. So even if we talk of girls, all girls are not similarly positioned. I mean, there's a caste which is acting with which is intersecting with gender. There could be the religion, there could be the region. So several factors, how they pan out and how they unfold in the field is really dependent on several factors. As you know, we don't have a singular identity. We have multiple identities which intersect with each other. So, first of all, the solutions that the policy proposes is like a homogeneous set of strategies, right? Solutions for all children who are dropping out. So, drop out is something which is kind of brings them together. Second is even if you kind of identify, which you must identify factors like variables like caste, class, religion, or poverty or migration or lack of transport, this, that, and the other, they need to be individually recognized. And then we need to propose strategies. So you can't club different people together and have one solution for all of them. And some of the solutions are also like, you know, like for instance, there's huge discrimination in school. We know that there is discrimination in school based on where you come from, who you are. There's visible discrimination, which is like, you know, making you stand out of the class, or discrimination when midday meal is being distributed, or when water. I mean, there are several instances we read about in the newspapers. There are also invisible discriminations, and that I think is more important. And there is work, there's enough research on that. Like, for instance, the way you're projected or stereotyped in textbooks, the fact that either you're not there at all, or if you're there, you're sort of distorted, sort of images conveyed in the textbook about a certain community, about a certain people. And there are pedagogic transactions, the way teachers interact with students, the way peers, students interact with each other, and how these identities of like caste and class and gender or religion kind of slip in. So so there's work around that also, that what happens in the classroom which pushes a child to drop out of school. I mean, there's this very popular book these days, good work by Nazia Irom, which is called Mothering a Muslim. So she, even though she's not a researcher, she's not an academic, but she's in her own child was to be born and she was wondering what name to give to her child. She was very conscious of the fact that if she gives a Muslim name, the child gets identified in a certain manner. And if she gets a secular name, then people don't get to know, at least in the first instance, who you are. And what she has done is she's interviewed children and parents across schools in the country, and she's found out that if you're a Muslim child, you do face additional discrimination. So being called a Paki or a terrorist and stuff like that, or a certain kind of dress you should wear, a skull cap and things like that. So there are lots of these, so it's not just open discrimination, but there are also lots of subtle ways in which schools discriminate against children who come from certain backgrounds. And poverty is, of course, always there. But the solution which is being proposed for poverty is, for instance, a non-formal education or an alternative path, which I think is not a good idea, because in principle, one needs to provide common schooling experiences to everybody across board. One, just because you can't, you may have problems, or you the policymakers think that you can't go to school or you will drop out. You can't, a lesser alternative cannot be suggested by the state. It's the state's responsibility to take care of needs of all the children. Then there is the non-detention policy, which was, I think, a really progressive measure, which was taken by the right to education. It said that children drop out because they fail. And when they, and there are children from certain backgrounds or certain difficult environments who fail, right? So the idea was that you don't detain child in the same class, at least till elementary school years, and let the child be. So RTE, because promises education 6 to 14, it also thought it makes sense to have a no detention clause, which will not, which means that even if a child fails in an internal kind of an assessment, the child is not held back, and there's no humiliation and there's no teasing of the child. This policy, this provision, unfortunately, was pulled back, and the states and the ministers and even the school principals and teachers, they all felt that, you know, this policy is doing a lot of harm and children are not learning and they don't know enough, and yet they pass from one grade to another. But the idea of this provision was to prevent dropout. And why children learn, how children learn, there are several other factors because of children learn. The teachers need to teach, teachers need to get time to be able to teach or interact with students. And there are several factors because the children are not learning, both at home and in school. So rather than, and this provision was meant only for preventing dropping out. So this provision was kind of pulled out, and they felt that yes, unless there's fear created in the mind of the child or the teacher, they don't really teach properly or children don't really learn. So a progressive provision which kind of was fairly prominent and useful in a landmark rights to education, where education becomes a fundamental right, you take two steps forward and four steps backward. So there were other provisions in the policy which were meant to ensure learning, so number of teaching days, curriculum, pedagogy, ways of assessment, teacher duties and how you look at curriculum, pedagogy, this, that and the other, infrastructure. So that's one thing which was there, and because of which children do fail, you withdrew it. You kind of thought it's best to remove the provision, even though this provision existed before the right to education also in policies of several state governments as well, where attendance probably was made mandatory or things like that. But here you removed the provision. So you identify a problem, you give a solution, and then you think the solution is to, like, you know, to are going to make children less serious about studies and so on and so forth. So you remove the provision, and that was really unfortunate. The other thing which the policy talks about is, again, a bit problematic, because they talk about, in more so in education, we often think in terms of binaries, either this or that. So either a traditional classroom or a progressive classroom, a child-centered curriculum, a teacher-centered kind of curriculum, power with either the teacher or the child. So formative assessment versus summative assessment. So we have a tendency to think in terms of dichotomies, which really creates a lot of problems. Even though it provides a critical link with which you look at educational world, it does confine you in certain ways, and you start opposing, you fall in either or camp and start opposing whatever is coming from the other camp. So for the longest time ever, our country and a lot of other countries focused on inputs which should get into the school. So, you know, and which makes for quality education. So you have the school infrastructure, you have toilets in your playground, you have laboratories, you have boundary wall, you have teachers, trained teachers, you have a heterogeneous mix of students studying in school. So there are lots of factors which get into a school to make it better, and you assume that that's linked to quality education. So there is a provision, for instance, in the RTE, which says that if you were to set up a school, you must take care of A, B, C, D, E, F, right? So the infrastructure is an important part of it, and a certain pupil-teacher ratio, a certain teacher needs to be qualified and stuff like that. But now, ever since mainly Pratham has got into these assessing children's learning kind of surveys, the ASAR, what we call the ASAR, which comes out every year. So since 2005, they've been going to rural areas and assessing children's learning, and they've been saying that children are not really learning. So what is the conclusion that you arrive at? That despite the inputs, we've talked enough of inputs, and despite the inputs of children are not learning, and they're not being able to, and they're tested largely on minimal skill, like foundation literacy and numeracy. So despite all this, children are not being able to do that. So let's now shift the debate from the inputs to outputs. So forget about inputs. Let's concentrate on outputs. And you make a teacher more accountable. You test the child. If the child is doing well, the teacher is kind of applauded. If the child doesn't do well, then direct relation, unilateral relation is drawn between the child's performance and the teacher's performance, teacher's accountability. And the teacher is thrown out. This is, again, a big problem that you forget. So it's from inputs. It's either inputs and outputs. And we know that both inputs and outputs are equally important. You can't say that inputs are bahut, like we've talked enough of inputs, now let's focus on outputs and let's ensure that children learn and that learning be visible, that let that learning be measurable, that let there be accountability. So this is the direction in which you're going, and that's sad, because inputs also matter. If you're talking about dropout, for instance, the fact that you don't have a toilet in school, girls don't have a functional toilet in school, will ensure at some point or the other, especially after puberty, she might miss school or eventually might drop out and stuff like that, or there's no safe boundary wall across the school. These are important factors, and they need to be taken care of, both from the input and the output side. And if children are dropping out because there's no teaching happening, or they're being discriminated against, or they're being teased, then one needs to recognize that these spaces also need to be examined, and we need to be very careful as to what we're teaching our children, how we're interacting with them, the kind of images that are being, the ways in which they're being projected in the textbooks. So it's a complex problem, but it's not that because the complexities in the problem, you can't resolve it. It of course needs multiple nuanced kind of solutions to address them. But if our tendency, if we believe in a very quick fix kind of a immediate solution where you're homogenizing problems, you're homogenizing solutions, you're homogenizing children, then obviously we'll continue to struggle. And most of our children, I think, need to be treated with dignity, the dignity that they deserve. And even a toilet has to do with dignity, frankly, according to me. If there's no toilet in the school for you, or if the toilet which is meant only for teachers, the way you're treated, that the assumption that you probably don't have toilet in school, so why do you need toilet? You probably don't have toilet at home, so why do you need a toilet in school? So all these factors lead a child to push out of school. And it's important that the state takes the responsibility, because the state has the wherewithal. You can't expect volunteers to, like, in the last ASAR report also, I remember, there's this thing of volunteerism, that we will find student volunteers or retired officers or retired old people, senior citizens, local experts, and we'll expect them to. So volunteerism, that's like an oxymoron, I think, that you expect people to volunteer, but volunteerism is about me volunteering, not somebody else telling me to be a volunteer. And these are good solutions in terms of, why not? Yes, of course, you have people helping each other, peer tutoring, this, that, and the other. There are good ideas where you build a robust community. But the state can't be saying that, because if the state says that, then somewhere the responsibility shifts from the state to these volunteers or these people, common people, civil society. And that's the problem. The state cannot take responsibility for educating its children, for providing them the requisite support. Then you can't expect these forced volunteers to address the problem. It's all very good in non-formal kind of settings or in but it can't, the state, for a state to take a stand like this, where it's depending on volunteers and passionate people, committed people, enthusiastic people to take care of what they should be doing, then there is a problem.
So, ma'am, I think you brought a lot of these issues that are pertaining to this idea of dropouts here. And So, and also you said this the idea of that how the state is now shifting its responsibility to the volunteers, the civil society, or the passionate teachers. So even you see that the policy on one hand speaks on re-establishing the credibility of the government schools, but also inviting the public philanthropic partnership school models to ensure this universalization of access to education. So how do you see this approach?
Frankly, I would not like to pile on to the new policy entirely, because even though it has several objectionable elements in it, it is not that some of those elements in it did not exist before. I mean, the policy is majorly criticized for being pushing the child further to the margin, right? But and having a layered kind of an education system. But right from our independence, we've had a layered education system. So if you look at both public and private, we've had multiple layers of schools. And the NP in 1986 introduced the non-formal education for a child labor or potential dropout. So a girl was likely to stay home to take care of the siblings. So it is not that sometimes we, like I said, the moment you start seeing problem in binary, that's when we get excited and totally so it is not that Kothari Commission did talk of a common school system. It remained on paper. It never got implemented. So aisa nahi ki this policy, private-public partnership has been on for, in fact, private players have always, like Christian missionaries have always played an important role. And since the 1990s, ever since we went the path of liberalization, globalization, privatization, we've had private sector playing, private for-profit sector playing very important role. We've had international schools, international universities. So it is not that there's a sharp discontinuity, and I think, isn't it? We the PPP is not a new term. I mean, we have been. So only thing is policy is also furthering it, But it is not that it's coming from the policy. That, I think, may be unfair. I mean, if I have to play the devil's advocate, much as I would like to critique the policy, which I have, in fact, but I'm saying that it's not fair to say that we were offering equitable educational opportunities to our children. We were not. The alternative, innovative education guarantee scheme, alternative schools, non-formal, multiple pathways, already they did exist, isn't it? Policy to abhi aayi hai, it's not got implemented, but we've been smug. Para teachers, contractualization of teachers, paying them less, calling them all kinds of fancy guru mitra, guru shik, all kinds of fancy names to give it more legitimacy. But we've had teachers who are really disempowered and so it's not that the new policy is doing it. I mean, I don't know. I don't think it's fair to say that. But yes, the policy also, some ideas continue to be. And some ideas they are furthering. Constitutional values, I think that's an important critique, that the way they look at constitutional values and framework, that occurrence possibly is definitely a problem which is there in the policy. So instead of secular democratic republic, they're talking of values like courtesy, sacrifice, discipline. I mean, why the hell would you want to teach child sacrifice, and who should sacrifice for whom and why? So those are the issues. The other is heightened glorification of ancient Indian civilization, culture, language, Sanskrit, this, that, and the other. So there are a few new features. But this again, this crediting of the constitutional framework and a very strong negative, Hindu's agenda was also there. Each time there was a change in government, the textbooks did change. So I'm not quite sure that, and that's a fact that since 47 or 50 or whenever, we've been fairly smug in having a layered education system. You have a Kendriya Vidyalaya, you have a Navodaya Vidyalaya, you have a Sainik school, you have Pratibha Bal Vikas Vidyalaya, you have the 25% poor children into fancy private schools. Then within the private also you have several layers, right? You have the fancy skin sensor, tap kind of schools, AC buses, and you have schools where they're functioning from basements and garages and all. So it's just, I wouldn't like to, if you understand the context which has been there for a long time, the context has been like this. The excessive focus on testing, teacher accountability, learning outcomes, efficiency, managerial discourse has been around for some time. But to me, I think if the main policy that you, the main objection is, of course, these fundamental problems like violating constitutional framework and this, that, and the other. But it's also the fact that you're unabashed about it. You don't recognize that there is a problem. You don't even do it quietly or surreptitiously. You're doing it. You're very open about it. You're very blasé about the whole thing, and you're going ahead with a certain agenda. That probably, to me, is a problem. But privatization to hai. Pehle se hai. States are happy with it because they get to pile on to the private sector. Private sector is happy because they're making profit. So you have low-cost schools for the poor children now.
So
bottom line, Soham, is... bottom line, if I can say that, not really, it's been a long, long time. The RTE also happened in 2009, like the constitution made in 1950. So the poor child, the disadvantaged child, I mean, the marginalized child because of whatever reasons, I think generally hasn't pushed around quite a bit. It's not that, so it continues to get pushed around.
So if I can pitch in, so do you see this layered school systems giving a better choices for the parents to decide?
Had it been equal layering, yes. But this is not an equal layering. This is a stratified layering. I remember many years back, I used to hear this ad that Maggi different, like, you know, the Maggi sauce, it's different. It's different. So that's the way they promoted it. So basically, if you're talking of diversity and there's equal diversity, one can understand. But here we know that Hindu versus Muslim, poor versus rich, Brahmin versus Dalit. Guys, there is a stratification. There's a layering of better and worst. It is not an equal diversity, isn't it? So Kendriya Vidyalaya, you can't compare a Kendriya Vidyalaya in terms of the support that it gets, in terms of the infrastructure that it gets, instead of finances which are allotted to it, in terms of teachers who teach there, in terms of students who come there. You can't compare it with a municipal school, which is again a government public school. So let's not fool ourselves. So coming back to the policy, that's the thing that they do mention it, but somehow this entire policy is also very rushed. It's in an attempt to probably make it short, it's got condensed, and it appears to be random and erratic. Suddenly some new sentence gets added, a new idea gets added to an idea which is not related. But that's a fact. We better accept that we're all responsible for the state of education that is there today. Not that you were doing wonderful work before, and all this is totally new. It's a nahi hai. Most of the things which are being talked about, which are being critiqued, some of them have definitely been there. So the idea of fun, for instance, the idea of fun, activity-based learning, engaging, interesting, enjoyable, these terms are there in the policy. This, again, is a problem, and especially it's linked to the education of poor children. So unko maza aana chahiye. Maza aayega, to padhai na ho, koi baat nahi, maza aana chahiye. So activity-based learning, fun and learning. It doesn't apply to fans, the well-off, the better-off schools, right? You don't think I don't remember having ever been concerned about having fun and learning. Even if it was painful, we better learn or we better study or we better get onto the task. The idea of fun, the idea of trivializing, the idea of reducing the curriculum content usually is applicable to programs for the poor and the disadvantaged. There you want them to have fun. So fun is not a bad idea, but if you're only having fun, then there's a problem.
So given that there are so many issues that do exist and there are certain recommendations, there's still the NEP 2020 aims to achieve 100% gross enrollment ratio from preschool to secondary level by 2030. So how do you think, how realistic is this target?
I don't know. I don't think I'll be able to comment on that. Ram jane, literally Ram jane. I don't know. I mean, I don't know. But it's just that this section is not. If you look at this section, if you think in terms of supporting the policy, or if you think in terms of implementing the policy, then I think the fact that it's there, it's a good thing that it finds its presence in the policy. I think we need to have a layered understanding of what the reasons why children are dropping out, and then propose strategies. A, and we don't alternative pathways is a problem, like, you know, so that I think can be avoided. And depending more on volunteers and, you know, good do gooders in society, that's a problem according to me. But we can certainly flesh it out and think in terms of how to implement this clause. The idea is, the objective is noble and the objective needs to be addressed. It's been there for quite, the problem has been there for quite some time. So if you have a layered understanding of why children drop out, I think it will be better placed or positioned to help the government reduce the dropout. Because unless you understand the problem well, how do you propose a solution which is a blanket solution for everybody? It's not going to work.
So completely agreed with you on the idea that there are this lot of these recommendations which might be very good in sound, but also there is a very gross misunderstanding of these issues, that why these dropouts happened, and that has not been put out in this policy. So that I can make from your anything that you want to add something out here.
No, generally, you know, on education, everyone is an expert. Everyone is an expert. Either you've been to school, or if you've not been to school, somebody else has been to, somebody you know has been to school. Or so people, or the children are going to school. So everyone has an opinion on education. They all think that they're experts. Now if you look at the NEP also, I mean, every day there's a discussion in NEP, which is a good thing. I think I've also been part of these several discussions. Mm-hmm. But randomly, the tutorials, teaching, preparing students for IAS, or everyone is talking about the NEP. So they... on education, people have an opinion, then they think they know best. But like education researchers, which we keep doing and which I keep reiterating in the class, I mean, let's pause a bit and let's understand the problem and let's not be judgmental, let's not be in a hurry to, like, you know, implement it. Like, there's no non-detention. People didn't really understand that this was not meant to make children learn. Yeah, there's several other things which, because of which children will learn, put them in order. This was meant to just let the child stay on, because you're promising an 8-year education to the child in school. Let the child stay on. Yeah? Even, and I'm saying that on record, even if the child's not learning, just the confidence, just the fact that he's not doing something else or child labor, or, like, you know, just the fact the child is in school, that gives enormous confidence to the school, to the child. So there are factors which needs to be put in place for children to learn. But this provision was not meant for that. This was simply to reduce dropout. Mm-hmm. And that they kind of fail to recognize, and in a huge hurry to just slash it. And so there are lots of things which are not in order. All that is okay, but let not children have it easy. If they are failing, if they don't know, let them fail. Let them pay the price for something which they are not responsible for. So, yeah, that's the way. That's the sad reality of our times.
Yeah. I think it's also brings back to this topic of that education is also multidisciplinary, and you invite a lot of people to this field. So, and it makes also this field way more maybe problematic, and maybe very gross misunderstanding of the different issues.
Yeah, and homogenizing everyone, homogenizing people, schools, and giving random solutions according to what they think works.
Yeah.
So everyone has an education. Yeah.
So thank you so much, ma'am. I think it is really helpful. It is really helpful to get an overview understanding of how on the issue of dropouts and the universalization access of education. So thank you again.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time, ma'am.
That is all for today. We will be back with another episode shortly. This podcast is brought to you by the Center for Excellence in Teacher Education Initiative at Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. Thank you for listening. Have a good day.